Hi, I'm David Barker, pastor here at Central Longmont Presbyterian Church. And on behalf of all of us at Central Longmont, I want to welcome you to this service of worship. Whoever you are, wherever you are, however, whenever you have found your way to us, we are glad that you did. Welcome. I am sitting on a very small chair. You can't see how small it is, but my knees are nearly up to my chest. But that's because I'm in the nursery, where pretty much all of the chairs are small. And I'm here in the nursery because I wanted you to have the opportunity to see this. You may remember that last week I showed you the renovations that had been done to the basement bathroom facilities. And this is another piece of that, a piece that you didn't see last week. Because in the process of doing those renovations, we're doing some renovations and repurposing of the nursery, and that includes the bathroom. And I particularly wanted you to see the world's smallest toilet. It is a child's size toilet. And if a toilet can be cute, I think that's it. When you get the opportunity to come back in the building, after you have seen the other facilities, make a point of coming to the nursery so you can see the work that is being done here. Not quite as far along here as we are in the other part. This part still has little to go. The other part is done. But my guess is that by the time that you are able to come down and see it, things are going to be in pretty good shape. It is cute, isn't it? We're glad you're here. Welcome. And let's worship God.
Thank you. Good morning. For today's moment for mission, will you please help me in welcoming Barb Boltice from Crossroads School? Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Barb Boltice, and I'm the Executive Director and one of the founders at Crossroads School. We are so grateful to Central Longmont Church for sharing your building with us for 6 years and for continuing to support our students in a variety of ways since we moved last summer. For those of you who may not be as familiar with Crossroads, we're a Christian alternative school for students in 6th through 12th grades, focused on those who are failing at traditional schools for a variety of reasons. At Crossroads, students are in classes of 8 to 10 with a highly relational, individualized, mastery-based program that rebuilds their confidence and skills, helps them earn a diploma, introduces them to the love of Jesus, and helps them make a positive plan for their future. I'd like to share a couple of recent success stories with you. The first is John Martin, who came to Crossroads in 9th grade, struggling with anger management and bullying and needing extra time to finish his work. John is now a confident young man who took a 5th year to finish high school, but graduated in May and plans to enlist in the Marines. The next is Jackie, a pregnant 20-year-old who dropped out of school, then tried to go back to finish in a regular public school, only to be told that she couldn't because she would turn 21 before she finished her graduation requirements. At Crossroads, she worked very hard to finish a year's worth of science in only 2 months, despite the quarantine, and now has both her diploma and greater confidence in her ability to conquer challenges as she looks forward to becoming a mom in September. All of our students have stories as unique and individual as John's and Jackie's. They have learning disabilities, autism spectrum disorders, chaotic family lives, mental health challenges, and even more. So these smart, creative kids simply don't fit in a traditional school system. They begin to give up on themselves and on their schooling. But we believe that these students are precious to God and valuable to our community. And we want to help them find hope and a future. And the funding, volunteers, and prayer support of Central Longmont Church is helping to make this happen. We're planning for the fall and hoping that we'll be able to go back to regular classes because of our small class sizes. But even if we have to be quarantined some of the time, teachers will continue to reach out to students one-on-one, the same as they do in person, to give them the structure, encouragement, and relational support that they need to turn their lives around and work toward a positive future. When you think of Crossroads, please pray for our students and staff. And if you're interested in learning more, please check out our website at crossroadslongmont.org or give me a call. I'd love to meet for real or virtual coffee and talk about how you might get involved. On behalf of all of our staff, volunteers, and especially our students, thank you again. Together, we are changing our world, one life at a time.
Good morning. Please join in saying the welcome, and the words will be shown on the screen. We gather this day bringing with us our hopes and dreams, doubts and fears. Whether you're a visitor, guest, or friend, you are welcome here. If you are fighting disease or recovering from injury, suffering from pain, or struggling mentally or emotionally, whatever your shame, your sorrow, your fears, your addictions, you are welcome here. Whether you're able to give generously of what you have, or what you have is barely enough to keep yourself going each day, you are welcome here. Whether you follow Jesus or don't know Jesus, whether your views are conservative, progressive, or indifferent, you are welcome here. Whoever you are, wherever you are in your faith journey, will come alongside you to worship, to learn, and to join hands in working in the community. You are welcome here. In Christ's name, all are welcome here. Now, please join me in today's opening prayer. Lord, stir our hearts that we might have the holy boldness to struggle for justice. Give us visions larger than those we create for ourselves. And root us in humility, Lord, that we might climb toward your heights through service. Amen. Now, please join us in singing the opening hymn, one of my favorites, Morning Has Broken. And again, the words will be on the screen.
Morning has broken like the first morning.
Please pray with me this prayer of lament from Psalm 142, reading from the words on the screen. With my voice I cry to the Lord. With my voice I make supplication to the Lord. I pour out my complaint before him. I tell my trouble before him. When my spirit is faint, you know my way. In the path where I walk, they have hidden a trap for me. Look on my right hand and see. There is no one who takes notice of me. No refuge remains to me. No one cares for me. I cry to you, O Lord. I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. Give heed to my cry, for I am brought very low. Save me from my persecutors, for they are too strong for me. Bring me out of prison, so that I may give thanks to your name. The righteous will surround me, for you will deal bountifully with me. Lord, stir our hearts that we might have the holy boldness to struggle for justice. Give us visions larger than those we create for ourselves. And root us in humility, Lord, that we might climb toward your heights through service. Amen. The Old Testament reading for today is from 2 Kings verses 9 through 15. In this excerpt, Naaman is an army commander and a mighty warrior who also suffers from leprosy. Naaman seeks help from the prophet Elisha, but is indignant at the simplicity of the instructions that Elisha gives him. He goes away angry until one of his servants persuades him to give it a try. You can follow along with the words shown on the screen. So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and halted at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, "Go wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean." But Naaman became angry and went away, saying, "I thought that for me he would surely come out and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and would wave his hand over the spot and cure the leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" He turned and went away in a rage. But his servants approached him and said, "Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it? How much more when all he said to you was, 'Wash and be clean'?" So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. His flesh was restored like the flesh of a young boy, and he was clean. Then he returned to the man of God, he and all his company. He came and stood before him and said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the earth except in Israel. Please accept a present from your servant."
Thank you.
Our gospel reading for this morning comes from the 13th chapter of Matthew, verses 31 through 33, and then verses 44 to 46. I invite you to follow along using the words on the screen as I read. He that is Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In the readings today from the book of Matthew, Jesus is telling us some more parables. That is, stories about regular everyday things told to help us learn about bigger ideas. And in these parables, the bigger idea is about the kingdom of heaven. And in the first reading, Jesus tells a story about a tiny seed. Let's take a look at some of the elements of this story. Jesus starts out by describing the mustard seed and how it's really small. But even though it's so small, it has everything it needs to grow once it's planted. So once it's in the earth, and it gets enough water and sunshine, and it begins to grow, it can grow all the way into its full tree, its whole self. It can grow all the way through using the nutrients and the sunlight and the water and all the instructions that it has inside itself, all that information to grow an entire tree that could even have birds in it. I think when Jesus is talking about this, he's also reminding us that we grow too, every day. And that just like how the tiny seed has enough information all in itself to grow into its full self, the full tree, we have information inside ourselves, that's our genetics, to help us grow into our full self. But we also have information or instructions, like from Jesus, about how to live and how we can grow in the actions that we take every day and grow not only ourselves, but also our friendships and our families and our communities, and grow our love for each other and how we can care for each other and also all the plants and living things all around us. Just like the tree grows from the seed and how actually every day, everything that's alive all over the planet is growing. So we can remember that as we can take the steps that we do every day in our own growth. We can remember the tiny seed and think about, even though one person might seem really tiny in the whole world, each person can grow into their full self. And like a tiny seed, we can help to grow the kingdom of heaven.
One of the great dark places of Scripture is Jesus' life between the time he was born and the time that he began his public ministry. The Gospels of Mark and John say nothing of Jesus' earthly life before he began his public ministry. They don't even talk about his birth. Matthew tells us of Jesus' flight to Egypt with Joseph and Mary to escape Herod, and that upon their return, the family settled in Nazareth. Luke tells us that Jesus, like all 8-day-old male Jewish babies, was presented in the temple, and that when Jesus was 12 and attended the Passover festival in Jerusalem, mom and dad unwittingly left him behind, where he amazed all who heard him with his questions and answers, but beyond this, nothing. The 30 years that separate Jesus' birth from the beginning of his public ministry are the proverbial closed book. There is, however, one thing we can probably assume with something approaching certainty, that those 30 years closed to us through the silence of Scripture were 30 years used to prepare Jesus to do what he came to earth to do. And if we can assume with reasonable certainty that it took 30 years to prepare Jesus for his public ministry, then that suggests that the first words out of his mouth once he begins, words 30 years in the making, are probably worth our attention. Now, this is something that I have suggested to you a number of times. Given that Jesus could have inaugurated his earthly ministry any way he chose, the fact that he chose to inaugurate it with 9 very specific words suggests that those words are of some significance. Now, the first of the 9, you may remember, was repent. Of interest to us this morning, though, are the 8 which followed, because those 8 words would tell us why Jesus said the first one. Because the kingdom of heaven has come near. What precisely do those 8 words mean? What does it mean that the kingdom of heaven has come near? And even more to the point, what does kingdom of heaven mean? These are important questions because Jesus is quoted in the Gospels as saying kingdom of heaven, or a similar phrase, 103 times. As I've also told you frequently, Jesus talked about the kingdom of heaven more than he talked about anything else. Well, to begin with, in using kingdom language, Jesus was speaking in a way readily understood by those to whom he was speaking. True enough, the phrase kingdom of heaven is found nowhere in the Old Testament. Yet the ideas of God as king and God using the Israelites as an instrument by which God's will for all creation would be done, all ideas central to the kingdom, are rampant from Genesis to Malachi. They are where the notion, for example, of covenant comes from. All those covenants with Abraham and Noah and Moses and David were based on a formula, in fact, used by Near Eastern kings among whom the Israelites moved and lived. All of which is to say that when the Israelites of Jesus' day heard kingdom, they were reminded of something very foundational to their identity as a people. Which brings us to the parables. The way which throughout his earthly ministry, Jesus most often chose to talk about the kingdom. The past 2 weeks, the lectionary has had us working our way through the 13th chapter of Matthew, which essentially is 58 verses of parable after parable about the kingdom. Now, our reading this morning presents us with a series of 5 short parables in quick succession. None of which, unlike those we have read the past 2 weeks, Jesus bothers to explain. The deciphering is left to those listening who can. As Jesus says, let those who can hear, hear. Taken together, these parables tell us a number of critical things. First, the parable of the mustard seed and the parable of the yeast remind us that the genesis, the potential of the kingdom, while inconspicuous, is in fact everywhere. From a tiny beginning among a handful of believers in the deserts of Palestine, it will grow to encompass all creation. And while the kingdom encompasses all, in the end, a sovereign God may choose not to include all. Because the kingdom is everywhere, it can be found like the pearl merchant intentionally seeking the pearl. Though sometimes, the world being what it is, we often find it when we aren't looking for it, by accident, like the treasure hidden in the field. And however we find the kingdom, or even if the kingdom finds us, it is of such extraordinary value that it is worth any price we have to pay, any sacrifice we have to make to have it. and the extraordinary value of the kingdom itself. What's that, we may wonder? This extraordinary value of the kingdom, is it salvation? Is it eternal life? Yes, and even more perhaps, joy. Jesus says, in his joy, the man who found the treasure in the field went and sold everything he had and bought that field. And the joy that comes from finding the kingdom is not just from finding the kingdom, but if you allow it, from the joy of transformation, of letting go, that you can be transformed by the love and grace of Jesus Christ, the operative term there being letting go. Letting go. I have a friend desperate to feel God. He reads the Bible, he goes to church regularly where he appreciates the fellowship and is as involved as he feels his life situation allows him to be. He very much considers himself a believer in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and yet for all that, he feels that somehow something is missing. Others seem to have a connection with the Lord, a dimension to their faith life that he doesn't have. Call it a joy. It's a joy he wants to feel, to experience, to live, but he's never been able to get there. He's tried. I mean, all his life, he's tried, but he never could. And eventually, he gave up. He still worships, still reads his Bible, still does fellowship, but he's resigned himself to the fact that this joy that he wants, he just isn't going to get. I think, my friend, this joy he seeks, he cannot find. It's because even more than he wants to have joy, he wants to be in control. Like an engineer studying a problem of mechanics, he wants faith to be rational, to be graspable. He wants complete understanding, everything to be ordered, logical. Now, he knows that isn't faith. It's the absence of complete understanding that makes faith. And he knows, too, that rational, graspable understanding is only going to take you so far. At some point, you have to be willing to let go. And he can't. Rather like Naaman. Naaman, presented with the gift of healing, of transformation, and the joy that it would bring, rather than putting himself at the mercy of the transformation, becomes indignant. Indignant because the transformation offered is not the way he understands such transformation should occur. And he was willing to turn his back on the gift and leave because it didn't. Only to be reminded by his servant, it's not about what you think, what you need it to be. It's about being faithful to God. It's about trusting. It's about letting go. The man in Jesus' parable who found the treasure hidden in the field, the pearl merchant who found the gift of great value, the pearl of great value, they didn't balk because the pearl didn't come to them in a way they could rationally understand. They didn't stop and reflect and cogitate and study and read and debate and argue until all their questions were resolved. They didn't wait until they'd attained complete understanding before committing to what they'd found. They simply let go. And in letting go, they received. Received what they could never have received if they hadn't let go. Which brings us to one of the most critically important elements of the kingdom. An element we will likely never fully understand because a full understanding requires reconciling that which cannot be reconciled. Jesus says it himself. The kingdom is here, but it is not here. The kingdom of heaven is within you, Jesus tells us. It is here, it is now. But also, Jesus says, pray that the kingdom will come. It is not here, not now. I mean, other kingdoms that we know anything about, the magic kingdom, for instance, it's not here, it's in Orlando or Anaheim. In any case, it isn't both here and not here. Certainly, I cannot simultaneously be here and not here, and neither can you. No one can. No thing can. Such are the laws of time and space. Something is either here or it isn't. Now, we might point out that, after all, we are talking here about God. And as theologians are quick to remind us, God is at one and the same time both immanent and transcendent, which is to say that God is completely everywhere, yet completely nowhere. And what is true of God surely must be true of the kingdom of God. If God transcends boundaries of time and space, so too must the kingdom. Yet we aren't God. Finite creatures that we are, we're stuck with being in one spot at one point in time. But if we allow ourselves to be tied in knots with the time and space barriers of Jesus saying that the kingdom is both here and not here, now but not yet, then we miss the point entirely. Whatever, whenever, wherever the kingdom of heaven is in theory, in practice, here and now, it's an ethic. Existentially speaking, the kingdom is intended to supply the rhythm to the lives of those who proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, a rhythm wherein we bear witness to the reality of transformation in our own lives, even as, through how we live among others, we bear witness to that reality to those of God's children who have not yet been transformed. That the kingdom is within us, even if it has yet to burst forth into the fullness God intends for all creation. I remember when Terry and I were trying to have our second child, the child who would be Jessica. Terry bought one of those home pregnancy kits. And because we are, after all, talking about a human life, the designers of these kits have taken out the guesswork. They straight up tell you, you're pregnant, you're not pregnant. There's no third option of a little bit pregnant. One cannot be a little bit pregnant. And yet it seems to me that when all is said and done, such an option is precisely what Jesus means in saying that the kingdom of heaven is here but not here. The kingdom exists whole and complete just as assuredly as a fetus that you could hold in the palm of your hand is a whole and complete human being. But in the realest of senses, the kingdom does not exist everywhere, does not exist in its totality anywhere. And so it is that we, as followers of Jesus, can possess the fullness of life that is ours as heirs to the atoning work that Jesus did on the cross for all people, yet at the same time, in looking around us, recognize that much of creation still lives in darkness, that we are once and for all redeemed, yet every day still living into that redemption. And yet, even if this whole business of the kingdom is irreconcilable, we might consider this. I've shared with you before the story of Norman MacLean's novel, A River Runs Through It, a story of a father with two sons. The younger son is profoundly gifted, gifted and full of promise. Yet the father, who, by the way, was a Presbyterian pastor, never understood him, never understood much of anything about his life or the way he lived it, and certainly didn't understand it when he, his younger son, barely a young man, is murdered. Yet, even though the father did not understand his younger son, he loved him. Loved him even at the expense of his older son. When, after the murder, the older son asks his father how he could so love someone he never really understood, his father simply says, "Because you can love completely without complete understanding." There is something in the father's words, I think, about letting go. About letting go and fully accepting what you cannot fully understand. The promise of the kingdom, the transformation of our lives by the grace and love of Jesus Christ, they're all real, but they are not automatic. We must first be willing to let go, to place ourselves in the hands of Jesus and say, "Not my will, Lord, but yours." And the letting go isn't easy. But maybe the letting go begins. Maybe the kingdom moves a little nearer, becomes a little more now, if and when we're willing to love completely without complete understanding. And so it is that the call to be a follower of Jesus, to be an agent of the kingdom, is the call to love other people completely without complete understanding. Amen.
Seeds grow more than we can conceive. Whose head the sandwiches reach for the sun. This is how God moves us each to believe. What is the world like when God's will is done? Witness the as the parent breaks into a run. This is how God longs for us when we run.
What is the world like when God's will is done? No more is neighbor, just the in places where once there was none. This is how God works when rivalries end.
What is the world like when God's will is done? Ready for feasting, we watch through the night.
Good morning, Central Family. As we go to our time of prayer today, I invite you to bring all of those joys and concerns that are on your hearts to God in prayer. Please join me. Gracious and loving God, we are thankful to be with you today. And while we are all spread far and wide, as we are worshiping together online, we know that we are all together in our hearts because you surround us with your love and your grace and your mercy, and you bind us together in those things as your children. Lord God, we lift up all those things that are on our hearts this morning, those things that are troubling us, those things that we feel helpless about, situations, health issues, loss, whatever it may be. And Lord God, we know that for those joys that we are celebrating, new lives coming into the world, good diagnoses, whatever it may be, you are dancing with us as we are celebrating. Lord God, there's so much going on in our world, and we are all in different places as we are working our way through these days. Some of us are working hard and finding new things to keep our minds and our time occupied. There are those of us who are feeling lost and not knowing where to turn and what to do to fill our days. And there's a little of everything else in between. There are those of us who are mourning the loss of loved ones, whether it's from COVID or from other illnesses or situations. We are in a time of grieving and missing those that we love so well. We ask that whatever the need may be, Lord God, that you are surrounding us with your love, that you are helping us to feel your presence in our lives for whatever those needs may be, and that you are surrounding us in whatever ways possible with friends and family, a card, a phone call, that you are showing up through others as we work through these times. Lord God, we think sometimes we need to pray for big, monumental things, that we need to be people in this world that have big, big moves, big ways of working in your community. And Lord, really what we need to do is one little tiny thing at a time, a smile at a stranger, a word of encouragement, a helping hand, a prayer sent that no one even knows about. There are so many small ways, Lord God, that we can be you in this world, that we can live the lives you have created us to live. So help us to do those small things this week, those kind words, those unknown things, just the little tiny things, because they grow into big things. They help others in the world feel more important, to feel better about themselves, maybe just to make something a little easier. So Lord God, as we all offer those little gestures, those little words of kindness, encouragement, and love, we ask that you bless them and multiply them in ways that make a huge difference in the lives of one another. Lord God, be our hands and our feet. Help us to use them and our eyes and our ears to see and to know and to hear your world. Help us to love your world as you have loved us. And help us to hear the cries of need and pain in this world. And give us the strength and the courage to move forward and help in some way. We lift all these things to you this morning, Lord God. We know that you hear our prayers, and we ask that you will continue to bless us and to guide us and to shape us as we are continuing to evolve more fully into the people that you have created us to be. We ask all these things in your name, and we pray together now the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to join us as we sing our closing song.
And now, my friends, I invite you to join me as we say together the words of our charge and blessing. You'll find them on the screen. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, help us to show love. Where there is injury, help us to be agents of healing. Where there is doubt, help us to live faith. Where there is despair, help us to give hope. Where there is darkness, help us to be light. Where there is sadness, help us to share joy. Lord, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. And let all God's people say, Amen. And may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you this day and all days to come. And one more time, let all God's people say, Amen. My friends, as always, in the coming week, stay well, stay safe, be kind to one another, love one another. We'll see you next week. Thank you. Thank you.